The split second during which the first Japanese bomb exploded in Pearl Harbor brought the United States into World War II. But the roots of that war lay buried in the past. World War I had changed the map of Europe. The industrial might of Germany was sharply curtailed. Sections of her former lands, lands which she herself had seized in the past, had been turned over to Belgium, France, Poland, and Czechoslovakia. She was stripped of her colonies. The once powerful Austro-Hungarian Empire had been divided into smaller countries whose strong feelings of nationalism and mutual antagonism created political and economic unrest. The vast Russian Empire had become a communist dictatorship, and there was fear of its spread throughout Europe. Many in the United States, disillusioned about war and Europe's political intrigues, sought to build a wall of isolation. During the Great Depression of the 1930s, Americans were largely preoccupied with their own difficulties. In Europe, the Depression caused a crisis in some of our lives. Some political leaders sought to capitalize on the fear of communism to create a counter-movement, the totalitarian dictatorship. In Italy, fear of communism helped Mussolini and his fascists, who took over the government in 1923. In Germany, the same fear helped Hitler and his National Socialists, or the Nazis as they came to be known, to take power in their methods, intense nationalism, given purpose by a drive for conquest, hate and violence against minority groups like Jews, Catholics, and national minorities. This same spirit of nationalism and conquest was exploited in Asia by a military clique which controlled Japan. These nations were bound together at first by common interests. Later, this coalition of Italy, Germany, and Japan was known as the Axis Powers. The League of Nations, established to maintain peace, failed to take strong action against the conquests of the Axis nations. Moreover, a rearmed Germany fitted the traditional British policy of balance of power, Germany against Russia. By postponing the outbreak of the conflict, many European leaders hoped it would be avoided. Thus developed the policy of appeasement, as it came to be called. Give in to Italy, Germany, and Japan to avoid the outbreak of war. And here is the record of the appeasement policy, which sounded so reasonable and so generous, and which failed so unhappily. In 1931, Japan invaded Manchuria and was not resisted. Later, when her action was condemned, Japan walked out of the League of Nations. In 1935, Italy invaded Ethiopia, and later, when her action was condemned, Italy walked out of the League of Nations. In 1935, Germany announced that it was rebuilding its armed might in defiance of the Versailles Treaty. Nothing was done to stop her. In 1936, the Spanish phalangists set up a totalitarian dictatorship with the help of Italy and Germany. In 1937, Germany occupied the Rhineland. In 1937, Japan invaded China. In 1938, Germany annexed Austria. But the hope remained that the armed conflict of World War II could be avoided. The policy of appeasement continued. Hitler demanded the Sudetenland of Czechoslovakia. To Germany went Chamberlain, head of the British government, and Daladier, head of the French government, seeking a compromise. They agreed to Hitler's demands in return for Hitler's promise of no more expansion. The high hopes of British leaders are reflected in the comment of Chamberlain, who, on returning to England from Munich, said,
"I bring you peace with honor. I believe it is peace in our time."
But there were other voices, too. Said Winston Churchill after Munich,
Britain and France had to choose between war and dishonor. They chose dishonor. They will have war.
It was a war of nerves in which Hitler was always the immediate victor. As the people of the United States learned of these events, they increasingly feared they would be faced by a great dilemma. Many sympathized with the victims of German, Italian, and Japanese expansion. Yet the great majority earnestly wanted to avoid responsibility for the tangled problems of Europe and Asia. Hoping to ensure neutrality, Congress passed a series of so-called Neutrality Acts from 1935 to 1937.
No loans or credits to nations at war. No shipments of war materials to nations at war. No United States citizens as passengers on ships of nations at war. American merchant ships to sail unarmed.
But there were growing doubts as to whether such policies could ensure neutrality or peace. In 1937, President Roosevelt announced his administration's intention of taking a more active but still cautious role in affairs outside our own country. It was the first of several stages in the formulation of American policy aimed at curbing the spread of Nazism and fascism. This first stage was diplomatic pressure. When the European powers met in Munich to decide the fate of Czechoslovakia, a formal message from the United States urged negotiation. Later, in view of Hitler's promise at Munich, the United States asked Germany to guarantee not to attack some 20 little countries. Hitler's reply, defiance. Our diplomatic advances were rebuffed. Hitler drew up a military alliance with Mussolini. In April 1939, Mussolini invaded Albania, and within a few days, Italy annexed that small country. Now Hitler turned his war of nerves upon Poland. Then came the events which stunned the rest of the world. A non-aggression pact between the two potential enemies of Eastern Europe exploded the British policy of balance of power and cleared the way for Germany's attack upon Poland and for the partition of Poland with the Soviet Union. On the fateful 1st of September, 1939, the German army surged into Poland. Britain and France, both of which had treaties of mutual defense with Poland, declared war on Germany on September 3rd, 1939. But the German war machine easily smashed through Poland with its lightning war, the Blitzkrieg, the war of the tanks against the cavalry. Tragic weeks, Poland was conquered. Invaded from the west by the Germans and from the east by the Russians. Russia seized her share. A new boundary line was drawn down the middle of Poland, separating the uneasy new allies. Treaties were forced upon Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia, which permitted the stationing of Russian troops. And later, Russia annexed these small countries. Moving to protect Leningrad, Russia demanded concessions from Finland, which the Finns would not accept. On November 30th, 1939, Russia attacked Finland. World opinion was strongly with the Finns, and Russia was condemned as an aggressor by the League of Nations. But after 4 months of tough fighting, Russia and the Finns came to terms, and Russia achieved many of her demands. Now came an ominous lull in the war. France cowered behind its massive Maginot Line of forts. England, behind the English Channel, feverishly converted to an all-out war economy. In the United States, there was talk of a phony war. The great debate over the policy which best served our interests grew in intensity. Our sympathies were with France and England, and we embarked on a policy of limited aid to the Allies. However, most Americans hoped to avoid war. Many argued that the best way to preserve civil rights for the world, to maintain the goal and dream of personal freedom, was through keeping the United States out of war.
I have asked the Congress to reassemble in extraordinary session in order that it may consider and act on changes in our neutrality law.
Congress reluctantly amended the neutrality law in November of 1939 to make war materials available, but only on a cash and carry basis, in their own ships. Britain and France immediately placed huge orders. Some could be shipped at once, but most would take months to fill. They caused American industry to gear up for war. In Europe, the volcano which had smoldered for 6 months suddenly erupted through the Maginot Line, north and west and south. In April 1940, without warning, Germany moved northward into Denmark and invaded Norway. On May 10th, the German army struck again. With paralyzing swiftness, the Blitzkrieg spread westward and southward over Europe. Great cities of Holland and Belgium were destroyed by German bombs. In France, the Maginot Line was flanked. German mechanized units forged ahead and behind it, cutting off French units and surrounding them. The German mechanized blitz was a new development in warfare, entirely different from the static trench warfare of a generation before. Within weeks, the great nation of France, one of the giant military powers of the world, was prostrate. The British Expeditionary Force was pushed into the sea at Dunkirk, but the army was saved only by pressing into service every available ship and boat from England, even fishing and pleasure craft. On June 10th, 1940, Italy moved into southern France to occupy areas she had long desired. Said President Roosevelt,
"The hand that held the dagger has struck it into the back of its neighbor."
In June of 1940, Paris fell without a struggle. France accepted a humiliating defeat. The northern half of France was occupied by the German army. Southern France, its capital at Vichy, was set up under a government of Frenchmen who were necessarily subservient to the German Nazis. Now England stood alone against the Nazis. General de Gaulle of the French army headed a so-called Free French Government in London. To fallen France, Winston Churchill, the new Prime Minister of England, spectacularly offered a full and equal merger of interests with the British Commonwealth. From London, the exiled governments of Poland, Belgium, Czechoslovakia, Holland, and Norway did their utmost to keep alive the spirit of resistance in their conquered homeland. To his own people, Winston Churchill said,
"I have nothing to offer but blood, tears, toil, and sweat. We have an ordeal before us of the most grievous kind."
Public opinion in the United States now reached a third state, that of all-out defense of the Western Hemisphere, together with still more overt aid to Great Britain. With England in danger, Congress voted immense sums to build a fleet for the Atlantic Ocean, designed to give the United States the first two-ocean navy in its history. President Roosevelt arranged to trade Great Britain 50 overage destroyers in return for 99-year leases on a number of naval bases in the Atlantic. Orders were placed for tens of thousands of planes and other war equipment. New factories were built to make this equipment. In September 1940, Congress passed the first peacetime draft in American history. The division of opinion in the United States was still such that this was approved by only one vote in the House of Representatives. Within the year, this program of preparedness had cost $37 billion, more than the entire cost of the First World War. And Roosevelt was able to say,
"Our most useful and immediate role is to act as an arsenal for them as well as for ourselves."
To most Americans, this arsenal was the answer to Churchill's challenge.
"Give us the tools, and we'll finish the job."
They hoped that our industrial might would throw the balance on the side of the Western Allies, and that American boys would not have to fight the Axis forces. The great debate in the United States raged with growing intensity. Roosevelt's re-election to an unprecedented third term in 1940 served to indicate that the majority favored the route he charted, a route which offered aid to the Allies, but which also promised to most Americans the avoidance of war. However, the issues of the campaign did not offer a clear-cut choice. The views of the Republican candidate, Wendell Willkie, on national and international affairs were not far removed from Roosevelt's.
"All Americans are of one mind. We want to assist the democracies in every way we can with materials and supplies."
In a speech to Congress in January 1941, Roosevelt issued a ringing declaration of hope to the conquered peoples of the world. In this, he named the four essential human freedoms. Freedom of speech and expression. Freedom of every person to worship God in his own way. Freedom from want. And freedom from fear. But in that summer of 1940, freedom from fear was only a goal. Germany's powerful air forces were pounding against the British Isles.
"We shall prove ourselves once again able defend our island home, to ride out the storm of war, and to outlive the menace of tyranny. If necessary, for years, if necessary, alone."
This war of bombs and aircraft has come to be called the Battle of Britain. It was the greatest aerial conflict in history. The Royal Air Force of Great Britain turned back the German attacks, and with the help of the new miracle of radar, made them too costly for the Luftwaffe. Without air superiority, Hitler may have felt that he dared not risk an attack across the Channel. During the winter of 1940 to 41, he consolidated his position on the continent. In September 1940, in a treaty known as the Pact of Berlin, Japan formally joined Germany and Italy as an Axis power. Japan's war with China, begun in 1937, was continuing. In 1939, the Japanese had seized the island of Hainan. Now, with Europe dominated by its Axis partners, Japan secured bases and the right to station troops in the French colony of Indochina and eyed the rich Dutch colonies of the East Indies. For years, Japanese leaders had proclaimed their plans for a new order in Greater East Asia. Now the day had dawned when it seemed possible for the so-called Greater East Asia co-prosperity sphere to embrace not only Japan, Manchuria, and China, but also the Philippines, Indochina, Thailand, Burma, and the East Indies. With a huge army and a navy larger than the combined Pacific fleets of all of Japan's potential enemies, her generals and admirals felt that the time had come to strike. The many top leaders who opposed such nationalistic aggression were powerless. In February and March of 1941, Hitler moved to the southeast. Through political pressure and by military force, the Germans occupied the Balkan countries, Romania, Bulgaria, Yugoslavia, then Greece, the island of Crete, Libya, perilously close to Britain's lifeline, the Suez Canal, and perilously close too to Germany's uneasy ally, the Soviet Union. In the United States, Congress implemented the arsenal of democracy concept with the Lend-Lease Bill, passed in March 1941 after a bitter debate. It gave the president authority to
sell, transfer, exchange, lease, lend defense materials and shipyard facilities to the government of any country whose defense the president deems vital to the defense of the United States.
That same month, the United States seized all Axis shipping in American ports, and in June 1941, closed Axis consulates. On June 22, 1941, Germany attacked Russia without warning, despite the two countries' non-aggression treaty. With the possibility of Japan's help from the East, a quick victory seemed likely. Hitler had seen the Soviet Union build up buffer states between itself and Germany and knew that Russia was displeased with German seizure of the Balkans. A victory over Russia, with all its resources and raw materials, would make Germany invincible. An attack on Russia was a dangerous venture for high stakes. Hitler now decided it was worth taking the chance. Within weeks, the German armies had captured the rich Ukraine and were preparing to dig in for the Russian winter. Its armies were at the gates of Moscow and Leningrad. Axis power was at its peak. In this desperate hour, many Americans demanded all-out aid to the Allies, short of war, and some were ready for war. Lend-lease shipments to the Allies had been steadily increasing and were now going to a new ally, Russia. In July 1941, Japan announced that she had assumed the protectorate over all of French Indochina. The next day, President Roosevelt received the armed forces of the Philippine Commonwealth into the United States Army and named General Douglas MacArthur to command the buildup of United States armed forces of the Far East. At the same time, President Roosevelt froze Japanese assets in the United States and in October placed an embargo on scrap iron and steel. In all these moves, Roosevelt worked in harmony with Prime Minister Churchill. In August 1941, the two leaders met in mid-Atlantic, where they drew up a joint declaration of war aims to keep alive the spirit of resistance in the conquered nations.
Sovereign rights and self-government restored. Access on equal terms to trade and to raw materials. Improved labor standards, economic advancement, and social security. The final destruction of the Nazi tyranny.
This was the Atlantic Charter, a statement of war aims around which the conquered nations of Europe and Asia could rally. In October 1941, Tojo, a key member of the Japanese War Party, was appointed premier. Japanese envoys came to Washington to negotiate with the United States. American terms were tough, presumably unacceptable to the Japanese government. Japan must get out of China and Indochina. While Japanese diplomats in Washington sparred for time, a fateful decision had already been made by Japan's war leaders. On December 7, 1941, Japan struck at Pearl Harbor and elsewhere. The next day, President Roosevelt appeared before a joint session of Congress.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. Last night, Japanese forces attacked Hong Kong. Last night, Japanese forces attacked Guam. Last night, Japanese forces attacked the Philippine Islands. Last night, the Japanese attacked Wake Island. And this morning, the Japanese attacked Midway Island. With confidence in our armed forces, with the unbounding determination of our people, we will gain the inevitable triumph, so help us God.